So in this presentation, I want to take a look at the two most commonly used RANS turbulence models and some meshing considerations when using them. So if we take a look at the user interface, we'll start in CFX. The turbulence model is found under the domain in the Fluid Models tab, and you'll see that by default, K-Epsilon is listed as the primary turbulence model. This is a standard model that's been used for many years with great success. In the pull-down menu, we have access to the more commonly used turbulence models, and you'll see second in the list is the Shear Stress Transport, and we simply select it and use it as is. If we move over to Fluent, the turbulence models are found under the Viscous Submodel panel, and we simply double-click on it, and again it gives us access to the more commonly used turbulence models. So we'll start with selecting K-Epsilon, and this gives us access to a lot of constants, so this panel can be quite confusing. However, it's highly recommended to just use the defaults. These model constants are typically only ever adjusted for academic cases, and we can simply select it as is and carry on setting up the model. To access the SST, we select the K omega model, and we come down to the submodel and we select SST. Again, the model constants are only ever changed for academic cases, and we can simply use all the defaults and move on with setting up the model. The main concern for the user in these turbulence models is the mesh resolution at the wall. For closure of the turbulence models, we actually need to look up data from this empirically derived chart, which is called the law of the wall chart. This straight section of the chart actually corresponds to the log layer of the boundary layer in the fluid flow. For the K-Epsilon model, this is as highly resolved as the wall gets. If we generate a mesh and the first element, which is shown here, is outside of this log layer, then we've not successfully captured this linear section of this graph. In this case, the data input into the equations, which is extracted from this chart, will not be accurate. In this case, we need to refine the mesh close to the wall so that our first node lies in this log layer and we have a more accurate number that's been put into the K-Epsilon equation. If we happen to over-refine the mesh and we put our first node in the viscous sublayer, which corresponds to this S shape of the curve, the solver will simply clip the Y plus value to 11. If we take a quick look at an example here, we have a simple duct with a backward-facing step and an inlet and an outlet. Here you can see I've got a fairly coarse mesh applied to the geometry. And when we take a look at the results, you can see a Y plus plotted on the wall, and you can see there's quite a large variation, but in this case, overall, the Y plus is a little bit too high, specifically where the flow is attached. So in this case, we simply go ahead and resolve the mesh specifically normal to the wall boundary conditions. And then when we take a look at the revised results, we can see that the Y plus values have come down. I want to point out that there's quite a range in the Y plus values. Despite having a fairly uniform mesh spacing close to the wall and a fairly uniform flow, we still get quite a range of Y plus values. At the inlet, we have a uniform velocity, so we get a high Y plus very close to the inlet. And as the velocity profile settles down and develops, the Y plus comes down. Again, when we're separating from the wall in this recirculation zone, the Y plus values are very, very low. And typically in these recirculation zones, we would ignore them. We wouldn't bother coarsening or refining the mesh to get a specific Y plus value. But the key point here is it's not a hard and fast number that we're aiming for. It's a general range of Y plus values with a specific mesh density. Similar to the K-Epsilon model, the SST model also uses this law of the wall chart to look up values. However, for the K omega equations, the S curve very close to the wall is also fully resolved. So with this model, if we generated a mesh and the first node was in the log layer corresponding to this linear region here, we haven't fully resolved the viscous sublayer, and we would want to refine the mesh normal to the wall to take advantage of the higher fidelity omega model in this region. So we would add these extra layers down here, and in this case we would be aiming for a Y plus of around about 1 versus the Y plus values of between 20 and 100 for the K-Epsilon model. One final note is the jump between the boundary layer and the free stream. Typically when we're using tetrahedrals, we have our prism-based boundary layer and then we have tetrahedrals in the free stream. It's very common to see a high resolution of the boundary layer with the prisms and then a sudden jump from the outer prism layer into a large tetrahedral in the free stream. This isn't really recommended. Large jumps in mesh size are typically less stable for the CFD solver. So in this case, we would want to increase the number of layers until the outer prism was of a similar size to the free stream tetrahedrals.